Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. Welcome to Faith Matters with Phillip Campbell, a Catholic variety program broadcasting on Good Shepherd Catholic Radio out of Jackson, Michigan. I am the aforementioned Phillip Campbell, your host and traveling companion for the next half hour, and I'm so pleased that you're tuning in here to Faith Matters. My friends, in the world we're living in today, faith is assaulted from all sides. The Christian faith in particular, but also the very idea of faith. Consider aggressive secularism that tells us that faith is irrelevant. Evils perpetrated by man that can cause us to question God's goodness or wisdom. It seems like any time we turn on the television or the radio and listen to what's going on in the world, we're constantly barraged by stories that seem calculated to increasingly shock and horrify us with the evils of our fellow men. There's atheistic scientism, which denies any evidence of intelligence in creation and endeavors to make religious belief look stupid. Then there's the sufferings and crosses in our own lives that tempt us to despair, that make us wonder, where is God? Why isn't he acting in my life in the way that I think he should? Why is he permitting myself or my family to undergo this suffering? And of course, scandals in the church among those who claim the name of Christ, which make a mockery of the gospel. And we can't forget what St. Peter says in the New Testament, the adversary, the devil, who he says walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. That's 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. In the face of all this, in the face of this intense onslaught against religious faith in the world today, we have to stop and ask ourselves, does faith matter? I think St. Peter also provides the answer to that in the verse we just quoted. If we go on with 1 Peter 5:8, he says, "The devil goeth about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, whom ye resist, being strong in faith." So St. Peter tells us that faith is the way that we resist and overcome the devil. Our faith is what overcomes the trials and tribulations of the world. But if faith does matter, how does it matter? What difference does God make? There was a great book by the late Cardinal Francis George of Chicago entitled The Difference God Makes. And it was written at the close of his life. Cardinal George died from a long, debilitating cancer. And as he was coming to the end of his life, he wrote this book, The Difference God Makes, which was meant to lay out the relevance of God today and God's importance, religious faith, the place of religious faith in culture and society. And it's a fascinating read. It raises many interesting topics for discussion. And it's my hope that on this program today and in subsequent episodes, that we can unpack some of these questions. So we should ask ourselves, what does faith mean to me? Both in the sense of what is faith, and also what does faith do in my life, or how am I different because of my Catholic faith? How does it tangibly affect the way that I choose to live? Or to put it another way, what does my identity as a Catholic mean to me? There's an old saying, don't let the first time your friends realize you are Catholic be when they show up to the funeral mass, right? They walk into the funeral mass and see the priest, oh, I didn't even know Bob was Catholic. Don't let that happen. We do have to ask ourselves, what does our identity as a Catholic mean to me personally, in the context of the world today, in how society is moving? So these are all big questions that we have to consider. But first, let's look at the idea of faith and dispel perhaps some deficient ideas about it that we might run into out in the world. Let me ask you this. How many times have you heard people say or infer that, well, faith means believing in something despite the fact that there's no evidence? Faith is essentially believing in lieu of facts. In other words, you have facts and hard knowledge on one side, And then you have faith on the other side. And faith is what you have when you don't have any knowledge, when you don't have any facts. It's essentially believing in something despite the fact that there's no evidence. That's a very common and errant view of faith. It reminds me of a story from when I used to be a director of religious education in a parish, and we were talking about mysteries of the faith, mysteries such as the Holy Trinity and the Eucharist and things like that. And a catechist told me that they asked the class if anyone knew what a mystery of the faith was. And a student replied, "A mystery is something we all believe, even though we know it's not true." the deficient ideas of faith out there, there's so many of them. Faith in God essentially gets lumped in with belief in Santa Claus. In other words, something that we all play along with for sentimental reasons, even though we know it's not true. Okay, one time when I was a DRE, I accidentally let it slip in front of a room full of elementary kids, what we'll call the truth about Santa Claus. I didn't mean to, but it just accidentally came out. Oh boy, my pastor got angry calls about that for a week from parents. How dare your DRE take away my child's innocent belief in Santa Claus? I learned never to talk about Santa Claus again, yet here I am doing it on the radio. You know, people can get really sentimental about their faith. There's something about faith that feels very, it feels very innocent to just be able to believe, to just simply be able to have faith. There's something innocent about that. And you know what's fascinating to me is often when the substance of faith has faded away from a person's life, people will still cling to the sentimentality of Catholicism. They might no longer believe what the church teaches. They don't believe in the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist. They don't believe in salvation through Jesus Christ. They don't care what the Pope says. But they still go to Mass at Christmas because their parents used to take them when they were young. And it feels good. And it feels innocent. And it feels wholesome. And indeed, it is good and innocent and wholesome. Faith, in its own way, is a simple and beautiful and innocent thing. So don't think I'm bashing Christmas, Easter Catholics, right? We'd love to see y'all more often, of course, than Christmas or Easter. But if anything, the fact that people will still hold on to a sentimentality about faith, even if the substance of it has faded from their lives, it's a testament to the reality that religious faith is a very appealing thing. The Catechism of the Catholic Church says that man has an inherent need for God, an inherent desire to prostrate himself before something, to adore something. And when it's rightly ordered, that's going to be God that we adore, of course. When it's wrongly ordered, that's going to be money or pleasure or success or any of those sorts of things. But we all have this sentimentality about faith. It's so appealing. People will cling to it and cling to the externals of faith, even if they've lost the substance of faith. There's a great book. One of my favorite books is called The Little World of Don Camillo. It's by an Italian author, Giovanni Guareschi, who wrote in the years after World War II. And it takes place in this charming little Italian village. And the protagonist is a priest, Don Camillo. And in the setting that Guareschi paints for us in the book, the village is kind of split between the faithful Catholic rustic population, and then there's the local communist party headed by the mayor, Papone, who's always trying to use his resources to antagonize Don Camillo and mock religious faith. And there's this great scene in the book when all the communists come into the parish church for the purpose of harassing Don Camillo. Remember, these are communists. They're a hardcore, militant, violent atheists. And they walk in the church, and what do you think they do when they walk in the church? They all take their hats off when they get into the building. And Don Camillo makes a point about this. You might be communist, but you're also Italians. And Catholicism was so ingrained in Italian culture, even though these hardened communists had lost any sense of faith. They still had those externals of Catholicism, those sentimental things like you take your hat off when you go into a church. It's a lovely book. It's a charming read. If you want to read something that's really great and edifying, get The Little World of Don Camillo by Giovanni Guareschi. But of course, true faith is not mere sentiment. Belief in Jesus Christ, belief in God, is substantially different than belief in Santa Claus or the Tooth Fairy or something like that. And I know, by the way, because I believed in Santa Claus for a long time until I was 12, probably. And this is because when I was young, my parents went all out trying to convince me. You know, I suspected that my dad was Santa Claus, and then he arranged to have a neighbor come over in a Santa Claus outfit so that they could be standing next to each other and I could see that my dad wasn't Santa. And I remember arguing with my friends until I was 12. No, he's real. But religious faith is essentially different. It's substantially different than the kind of childish belief we have in things like the Tooth Fairy. So what is faith? I've stated earlier, it's incorrect to see faith as, well, I believe it even though there's no evidence. Faith is not something that we have in lieu of knowledge. Faith is, in fact, a type of knowledge. It's a way of knowing the world. Based on what? Based on the word of someone else. That's essentially what faith is. It's a way of knowing based on the word of someone else. Now, I'm talking particularly about supernatural faith, but this is really true of any type of faith. We talk about human faith, having a faith in a person, like you say, oh, I have faith in my buddy Joe, or I have faith in this employee, I have faith in this institution. Anytime we're talking about having faith, we're essentially talking about a type of trust in a person. Let me give you an example. My grandfather fought in World War II. He's been dead now for 17 years, God rest his soul, but he was a World War II veteran. He fought in the Italian campaign. He was part of the force that landed in Italy in 1944 to drive the Germans out. And he was in the Po Valley campaign. And my grandfather's job in his platoon was to carry the 50-millimeter machine gun. This is the machine gun that goes on the tripod that you often see in movies. Anyhow, one day my grandpa's walking along with his platoon carrying the gun, and he didn't know there was German snipers along the ridge. And one of these snipers sees my grandfather walking, and he decides to take a shot at him. And he takes a shot. He was aiming for his head, as far as we can tell, but he missed, hit my grandfather in the arm, and knocked him over. And my grandfather came home from World War II with a Purple Heart for being wounded in the line of duty and a scar on his arm to show for it. Now, let me ask you this. How do I know this story? Was I there? Was I there in 1944 with my grandpa in the Po Valley in Italy? Did I witness this firsthand? Did I experience it? Did I get all the files on it from his platoon? No, I wasn't there. I didn't experience it. I didn't go through all the effort to verify the story. So how do I know about it? Why do I believe it? Well, I don't have access to the firsthand experiential knowledge of what happened that day. My knowledge is based on the trust I vest in my grandfather. Okay, sure, you're saying, well, he has the bullet wound to prove it. But I mean, I'm not a doctor. I don't know what a bullet hole after 60 years looks like. I don't know the different kinds of scars. Who knows? The fact is, the reason I believe, the reason I know about the story, is because I trust my grandfather's word, because he'd have no reason to lie to me. It's not because I independently verified everything. It's not because I went and did the research. I certainly wasn't there. In other words, I believe the story on faith, and that's the way faith works. And we learn so much about the world and our lives on faith. Any of you out there, you probably know a story about how your parents met. How do you know that? You weren't there. They told you, right? And you believe it on faith because you trust your parents. There's so many. This is how we learn about things that we don't experience, about things before we were born. Now, of course, independently verifying my grandpa's story would certainly strengthen my faith in him if I went and looked up those medical records, if I tracked down if there was any surviving members of his platoon that could verify the story or give me another version of it. Of course, all these things would strengthen my faith in him. They would reinforce his story. But ultimately, I have faith in him because he's trustworthy, not because I've went ahead and verified everything. So faith, even human faith, even just the natural faith we put in our parents and our friends, it's a type of trust. It's a type of knowledge based on the word of somebody else. Now in the New Testament, in the book of Hebrews, it says, faith is the evidence of things hoped for, the substance of things not seen. That's Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. And so the things of faith might be unseen. They might be things that are merely hoped for. But the book of Hebrews says they still have substance to them. They still have evidence. They're not ephemeral. They're not ghosts in the darkness. They're not wishful thinking. There's substance. There's evidence behind it. And we're going to spend a lot of episodes of this program exploring the substance of our faith. Certainly its teachings, but also its implications for morality, for society, its various expressions in music, culture, art, architecture, literature. The vistas of everything faith influences are really boundless. Faith touches on all these things. And faith is really transformative. Or I should say, it's transformative if you let it be. We mentioned 1 Peter chapter 5 earlier, the devil is like a lion, but the good thing is, so is the Catholic faith. And one of the names for our Lord is the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. There's an old saying that the Catholic faith itself is like a lion. You just need to open the door and let it out, and it'll take care of itself. The Lion of the Tribe of Judah has conquered, says Revelation chapter 5, verse 5. So faith certainly does a lot. It touches on so many aspects of our lives and our world. But on a very fundamental level, faith helps us find meaning. It aids us in making sense of the world and our lives and answering life's great questions. What is true? What does it mean to be human? How shall we live? What happens when we die? Faith gives us access to being able to answer these great questions, gives us a meaningful context for our lives. The Greek philosopher Aristotle once said, "Man, above all things, desires to know." That is, he defined one of the fundamental characteristics of the human race as an inquisitiveness, wanting to understand the meanings and the purposes behind things. Think about the very name for the human race, Homo sapiens. If you know your Latin, or heck, I guess if you just know your science, you know that Homo sapiens means thinking man. We crave knowledge as a species, but not just how. Have you ever noticed that questions never end? If you learn the answer to a question, it just brings forth more questions. If you were to say, what's on the other side of the ocean? And I say, well, there's a great mountain. And then your next question is, what's on the other side of the mountain? A river. What's on the other side of the river? A forest. What's on the other side of the forest? It just never ends. Humans are so inquisitive, but the point is, we don't just want to know the how, we want to know the why. That's what meaning is. Man thirsts for meaning in his life. When I was in college, I had to read a book called Man's Search for Meaning. It was by Viktor Frankl. Viktor Frankl was a Jewish, I want to say Austrian or German, psychotherapist. And during World War II, like many other Jews, he was arrested and put in a concentration camp. And while he was in the concentration camp, he noticed a very interesting phenomenon, which was that the prisoners who had a meaning to go on living, a reason to live, ended up having much better survival rates than those who gave up hope and despaired. The meaning could be anything. It could be, I need to get back to my child. It could be, I have a sick parent. It could be, my life's work is unfinished. It could be faith in God. But the point is, he noticed that those who had a meaning to their existence had a certain kind of will to persevere and go on living that those who despaired obviously lacked, and that this resulted in an actual difference of death rates among the inmates. And this fascinated him. And when he got out, he survived the concentration camp. And when he got back to civilian life, he created an entire psychiatric practice called logotherapy that was based on helping troubled people find healing by discovering meaning in their lives, because he found that once an individual has meaning, they have a certain vibrancy and a will to live that you don't have if you don't have meaning. Now, what you find your meaning in is a whole nother story, right? People can find meaning in all sorts of things, some of them good, some of them bad, some of them bizarre. So that's not what I'm talking about here. I'm simply pointing out that people crave meaning. It's part of our nature. It helps us make sense of things. Now, ultimately, only the Christian faith is going to provide a satisfactory meaning to life that gives us access to the truth about things. We are made for that. God makes us to find rest in Him, to be happy with Him here and in heaven. Or as St. Augustine says, our hearts are restless, O Lord, until they rest in Thee. Now, I plan on thoroughly exploring these ideas in future programs, but I think I've probably assaulted your ears enough for one day. But let's contemplate this today. How important is my faith to me? What does it mean to me? How does faith provide a meaningful context to my life? How relevant is the Catholic faith in my day-to-day decisions? As I'm going throughout my day, how often do I think of matters of faith, take them into consideration when I'm making decisions, when I have to confront life's challenges and sufferings? When I face something in my life, a trial or a cross or a tribulation, how much of a bulwark and a pillar is my faith to me? Or is it like those communists who go into the church and take their hat off and don't even know why they're doing it? Is it just some vestige of some sentimental thing from our youth that we still do and we don't really remember why? If that's the case, my friends, I challenge you to take the opportunity to reevaluate your faith, to go deeper with it, to really explore how much meaning it really has, and to grow in that. So I think that's enough for now. But until next time, this has been Faith Matters with Phillip Campbell. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift His countenance upon you and give you peace. God bless.